Good morning, Baker Chapel. It is so good to see you on this warm, sunny Sunday. If you are able, would you please stand for our opening song? If you haven't been here since we've been in the sanctuary and back in the sanctuary, just know that singing is welcome and encouraged, and so I want to hear your beautiful voices today.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, so lift your voice. Begin to believe, out of Zion till salvation comes.
These are the days of Ezekiel.
These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, so lift your voice. Begin to believe, out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, so lift your voice. Begin to believe, out of Zion till salvation comes. Until salvation comes. Until salvation comes.
Good morning. It is so good to see each and every one of you here this morning, and it is so good. Each and every Sunday brings something new back to the way we worship and back to the way we get along together as a community, right? Mug and Bun today, it's back, and so that's exciting. You're here. It's going to be a big day. I can only wait for what next week might bring. You may be seated now for a couple of announcements. One, I want to mention, I hope I got this information correctly, and you can correct me if I didn't, but our praise team is going to be performing next Saturday night. That's the 19th. They're going to be down at Boonville Johnson Park. So far, so good. Okay, from 6 to 8. 6 to 8, next Saturday night, Johnson Park, Boonville. Praise team, right? Okay, Lisa and I will not be here next week. Her middle child, John, is marrying Kelly, so that's the wedding weekend, and I have certain responsibilities, so I won't be here Sunday. Now, what I can do is there's something that's the equivalent of a speaker's bureau, and I can call the speaker's bureau, and we can have a guest preacher come in here. That's happened many times, right? And that's not a problem to do that again. What I would love to see, and I've asked several of you, Noelle responded in the affirmative, but she has an excuse next week, and she's not going to be able to fill in. But it would be great if, like, three of you would be willing just to give a 4 to 5 minute testimony. And if you did that, that'd be a 12 to 15 minute sermon. And that's the window I try to operate in myself. Everybody has a story. We call it a sermon. Everybody has an experience of God. Would you this morning, and as this day goes on, would you think about that? Would you think about whether you'd be willing just to share 4 to 5 minutes the way that God has worked and is working in your life? I think people would just be blessed by it if you would do that, okay? And let me know by this evening, because if I don't hear from you, I'm going to be calling the Speakers Bureau, okay? Also, an announcement about communion. We are This week and next week, we are going to continue to commune with these individual self-contained communion cups that we've been using. We're going to get a count of how many of these cups we have left after today, and then if we need to order more for next week, we will. But 2 weeks from today, then we are going to return to a way of communing that we're more used to. And so we will incorporate the bread back into the communion service. I hate to say it, but I think intinction is gone forever. I think it's just gone forever. It's too bad because it has become the tradition. Where drinking from the common cup was the tradition, that had to go by the wayside for health reasons. And now intinction is probably going to go by the wayside as well. But we are going to find ways. It'll always be the body and the blood. It'll always be deeply meaningful and deeply nourishing, and it's the major part of what we do in worship. And we're going to start getting back to whatever that turns out to be 2 weeks from today, okay? And so if you're new or visiting and you didn't pick up a communion cup, they're in the basket right outside the door, and you can just at any opportune time go back there and grab one if you haven't grabbed it already. Okay, we'll have other announcements during the announcement time, but I believe that's it for now. Would you stand and turn to your neighbor and greet them in the name of Christ? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, welcome to this service of worship here at Baker Chapel United Methodist Church. We have an appointment with Jesus this morning. Jesus is available always and everywhere by His Spirit, but He's made a special promise that if we would gather in His name, that He would be there among us. And that's exactly what we've done this morning. Sometimes we feel the Spirit, and sometimes we don't. But make no mistake about it, the Spirit is among us as we worship this morning. Okay, let's sing.
You know, we went last year where we tried to play more special music there for a time being so that maybe people didn't know all the words since they were encouraged not to sing. And then we went through a time of not having a PowerPoint, and so we tried to play things that maybe people would know. And but now we are in our sanctuary, and it is so good to be home and so good to be here with you guys. And so we've spent some time the past couple weeks just bringing out some of those old favorites that so many of you have expressed over the years that you've loved. So I'm so blessed to be able to worship with you this morning.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And oh, see how great, how great is our God.
Age to age,
age to age, he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit,
with me how great is our God. And oh, see how great.
Seated, and the children are invited to come forward now for the children's message with Melody.
Got here?
Apple.
An apple. Who likes apples?
Me.
Do you like apples? Do you like them with peanut butter on them? Have you ever tried that? Oh, apples and peanut butter. That's really good. Yeah, you have to try that. Okay. What's inside an apple? Do you know what's inside? You don't know? Okay. Let's see. Let's see if we can find. About a man, and his name was Johnny Appleseed. Sorry. Have you ever heard of Johnny Appleseed? Yeah. Well, Johnny Appleseed wasn't his real name. His real name was John Chapman, and he was a real person. He was born up in Massachusetts, that's up in the Northeast. Get the date right, in 1774. That was a long time ago. And in his 20s, he became a nurseryman. And that was someone who planted things. You like to plant things? Yeah. Do you like to plant things? Do you? Yeah, me too. I like to plant things. Sometimes they don't live, but I like to plant them anyway. And Johnny Appleseed, or John Chapman, liked apples. And so he went around planting the apple seeds and growing apple trees. Okay. And he did this all over. Now, you'll see pictures of him with a pot on his head for a hat. Why would you put a pan on your head? You don't know? I don't know either. But that's what he did. That was his cooking pot. And so he put it on his head. Okay. He would put it on his head and he would travel around and he would plant apple seeds everywhere. Well, the story of John Chapman should remind us of the story of Jesus. Jesus wants us to go around planting seeds. Now, he doesn't want us to plant apple seeds, although if you want to, you can and try to grow an apple tree. That'd be fine. He likes that, I'm sure. But he wants us to plant the seeds of the good news, the story of Jesus, and tell people all about him. So we're supposed to plant the story of Jesus in other people. Okay, so to do that, what do you think we have to do? What do you think, Genesis, if we're going to plant the seeds of Jesus in people, what do we have to do? Yeah, we have to tell the people how to do things, to listen to Jesus and trust Jesus and believe in Jesus. Exactly. So we're going to plant those seeds of Jesus in people. We have to go out and we have to tell people about Jesus. Okay? Now, when you eat an apple, some people are going to tell you that if you swallow the seed, that an apple tree will grow in your belly. I promise that's not true. I promise it's not true. So if you accidentally swallow an apple seed, you'll be all right. It won't grow in your belly. I promise, okay? I used to be scared to death of that, that a watermelon would grow in my belly. Okay. All right. All right, let's pray, guys. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for these children. And Lord, we hope that we plant in them the seeds of you, and that they can go out then and share the story of you with their friends and others that they meet. Lord, we ask you to put a hedge of protection around them, keep them safe, keep their families safe, and bring them back to us each week. We just ask all this in Jesus' precious name. And all God's children said, amen.
The gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark. This is the year of Mark, and so we'll be in Mark for the rest of the year. You might remember things happen quickly in Mark. The word immediately comes up often, very often. The section today is the first time where Jesus pauses to teach. You know, he came along, was baptized by John, went out to be tempted, cast out demons, healed the sick, called his disciples, and now he is teaching here in chapter 4. It is the tradition in the church to stand out of respect for the gospel, and so if you're able, please stand. Got away from the house this morning without my reading glasses, and so we're going to give this a try. If it doesn't work reading it from the Bible, I do have it printed out right there. Mark chapter 4, beginning with the 26th verse. This is Jesus speaking. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk and then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with the sickle, because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The word of the Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, it is good to be in your temple, among your people, in the presence of your Spirit and your Word, the body and the blood. God, it is good to come back week by week and seeing things return to normal. But Lord, let it not be normal. Let it be new. Let it be exciting. Let it be something that we can wrap our hearts and our minds around as we continue to follow you, to love on each other, even as we go out into the world to love the world as our neighbors, even as we love ourselves. It's in Christ's name we pray, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Back in the winter, I walked into Walmart, was going down to the lawn and garden section, was going to pick up a few things to be ready for spring. And in that aisle, right before you get to the sliding glass doors that go outside to the outdoor center, to the lawn and garden center, there was a display of flower bulbs. And it stopped me in my tracks because it made me think that back at home, there was a spot, a little patch in our landscaping that was bare. Now, our house was built in 2002. And I don't know whether this happened by the original owners or it happened later, but somebody professionally landscaped that lawn and that house. And you could tell it was done professionally. It's just beautiful. Well, Lisa and I are not gardeners or farmers. We've tried to take care of it. But I had noticed that where I think there were plants at one time, there was just bare soil. And to me, it looked like something that needed to be taken care of, even though I didn't necessarily know how to take care of it. But as I'm walking toward the lawn and garden center, there's this great big display of flower bulbs, and I'm like, okay, gladiolus, I'm going to get a couple of bags of these gladiolus, and I am going to plant them in that bare spot, okay? So I bought a couple of bags of them, and I went home, and I put them up in the garage. And they sat there, and they are dry and flaky and dead, really, just kind of dead. And they didn't do anything while they were sitting there on the shelf. But it said on the directions, it said, plant these in March or April. So about toward the end of March, I got those out, took them out to that bare spot, dug a hole, dropped a bulb into the hole, and covered it up with soil. Dug another hole, dropped a bulb in there, covered it up with soil. Did that about 20 times. That's all I did. I dug a hole, I dropped a bulb in the hole, and I covered it up with dirt. That's it. That was the extent of what I did. Now, these are my gladiolus right now. That's as they existed yesterday. It is the stalk. It is not yet the head. It is not yet the grain, or in this case, the flower. But you know what happened? All I did was what? I dug a hole, I dropped the bulb into the hole, I covered it with dirt, and I slept. And I slept. And one day I went out there, and there was a little sprout. What did I do? Nothing. I didn't do anything. A couple of days later, it's a little taller, and that's what it's like yesterday. All I had to do was trust the soil. All I had to do was trust the bulb. All I had to do was wait. And there it is, the stalk. And you know what else? I can trust with certainty that it is going to form a head. And it is going to form not a grain, but it's going to form a flower. I can trust it. I can trust that the soil and the seed and the sunshine and the rain is going to take care of that plant, and it is going to happen. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus describes the kingdom of God as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. I love that. He does not know how. But it happens. It happens. Not to diminish the hard work that farming is, but if you're growing corn or you're growing soybeans or whatever you're growing, I know you have an important role in that. God brings the growth in God's good earth. That's what happens, and farmers trust that. Farmers trust that the soil is going to do what the soil is intended to do, and the seed is going to do what the seed was intended to do, and the sun and the moisture, and it's all going to come together, and it's a miracle. Now, we can explain it. I can't probably explain it very well, but we could talk about cell division or germination or biology or pollinate, whatever you want to talk, we can kind of try to understand it, but it's a miracle. Is it not a miracle that a seed grows, produces fruit, produces a harvest. It's a miracle. And God uses that to explain the way it is with the kingdom of God. Now, we have some problems with the term kingdom of God because we don't live in a kingdom. We live in a form of democracy called a representative republic. We are supposedly self-governing. We don't have a king, and so it doesn't register with us right away, and so we kind of have to adjust, because Jesus is not talking about a kingdom in that sense of the word. He's not talking about a geographical area with well-defined borders. He's not talking about a place. If he is talking about a place, he's not talking about a well-defined small place. He's talking about all of creation, if he's talking about a place at all. But what Jesus is really talking about is the reign of God, the rule of God. And the kingdom of God, the reign of God, the rule of God is a thing of the past, it's a thing of the present, and it's a thing of the future. God reigns, and God has always reigned. God created this earth. God reigns over this earth. He reigns now as well. But in Jesus, Jesus comes to announce something new, that God has come in Christ. God has come in the incarnation, and Jesus is announcing the fulfillment of the kingdom. Some speak of it as a now and not yet. The kingdom is now. It is also not yet. Jesus only gives two speeches in the Gospel of Mark. The Gospel of Mark is a lot more about Jesus doing things, about actions. He only has two speeches. This one in chapter 4, where he tells all these parables. Then in chapter 13, he speaks apocalyptically. He speaks about the end times. He speaks about when he comes back in the second coming and the fulfillment of that kingdom on earth. But the kingdom is now. The kingdom always has been, and the kingdom is to come. We also can get a clue as to what the kingdom is if we look at Jesus' own prayer, the prayer that he taught. And that prayer uses a Hebrew literary device called parallelism, where the second line in the verse defines the first line. And we pray this, don't we, in the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Second line defining the first line. What is the kingdom? It is where the will of God is done. If the will of God is being done, that's the kingdom. That's the reign of God right there. And that kingdom is marked by forgiveness. It is marked by unselfish service. It is marked by radical love. And it's what Jesus came to usher in. Turn back to chapter 1. The very first words out of Jesus' mouth in the Gospel of Mark are these. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Jesus was also a man of his own time and place. And Jesus and his contemporaries were living under the domination of Rome. They were living in Roman-occupied territory. And the Romans ruled by domination. And Jesus comes to say, no, God reigns, and God doesn't reign by domination. God reigns by love. And this is what Jesus came to announce. And so, in our gospel this morning, Jesus tells two parables to explain what he means by the kingdom of God. What is it really all about? Now, before he tells these two, he told the parable of the sower. That's a very familiar one. That comes in another year in the lectionary. This year we have these two parables, and I love them. The second parable is also a familiar one, and it's the parable of the mustard seed. And the point being that the mustard seed being very tiny, Jesus is saying from something that is exceedingly small, something exceedingly large grows. And so he's saying, I may seem small. My following may seem small, but just as we can trust this plant to grow, then we can trust that this movement will grow. Indeed, it'll grow so large that it'll provide protection for all. But it starts from a very tiny seed, and it grows imperceptibly, mysteriously. But I want to deal in more detail with the first parable that we get in today's lesson. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come. I don't know about you, this is incredibly good news. This is incredibly good news. God does the work. God is responsible. All we do is plant the seed. The rest of it is up to God. That's hard for us. It's hard for us as Americans because we're proud of pulling ourselves up by the bootstraps. We're proud of being individuals. We're proud of getting it done. If something needs to get done, I'm going to do it. That's built into who we are. It's also built into who we are as the church. We are to be active as Christians. Our Christianity, our faith should lead us into doing things, right? To addressing those issues that face our world, addressing hunger and addressing war and addressing violence, all of those things. And all of those things are important, but we have to be very, very careful about the motivation for doing those things. When the United Methodist Church checks in with me, and they check in a lot, they might be checking in now, but when they check in with me, they have two main questions. Their first question is, how is it with your soul? They want to know, how is it with your soul? Are you in a group? How's your prayer life? How's your Bible study life? How's your soul? You're not burning out, are you? Because if you're burning out, you need to take some Sabbath rest. They're serious about that. How is it with your soul? The second question that they always ask is, how is your church being missional? How is your church being missional? What is your church doing outside the walls of the church? Is a popular phrase, the church has left the building. It's all about getting out there and mixing it up, meeting those needs and those causes wherever they appear. And that's all good. That's all appropriate. That's all appropriate. But what we have to understand, if we understand what Jesus is talking about with this parable, that is that we are not responsible for growing the church numerically or spiritually. We are not responsible for growing the church numerically or spiritually. That's God's work, and that's good news. That's exceedingly good news that God can be trusted with that work. COVID-19, wow, it has had all of us asking through the course of it, what's it going to be like? What's it going to be like? What's church going to be like? How much damage is going to be inflicted on us as a church body by this coronavirus pandemic? We were worshiping 130 people on average before COVID hit. We're now at about 90. You know, that can make somebody anxious who's looking at numbers that way. This is exceedingly good news. All we have to do is plant seeds. Keep on doing what you're doing. Just keep on doing what you're doing. Keep on loving yourself, loving each other, loving wherever you can, and trust God to grow it. We can count on it. We can absolutely count on it. There will be a harvest. Just as surely as those stalks will produce a head and then a flower, it'll produce that harvest. Just as surely as that's going to happen, Baker Chapel is going to continue to grow. God's church around the planet is going to continue to grow. It might grow in ways that we never expected, but God can be trusted to take care of his church just as surely as a farmer can trust that soil and that seed and that sunshine and that rain. God can be trusted to make it happen. And so let's move into our future with that confidence. Just keep on doing what you're doing. You're doing great. And a harvest and a big one is coming. Would you pray with me? As we meditate on this word opened for us this morning, let us try to see if we can get it to move from our heads and down into our hearts and to let it grow there in the soil of our hearts, that it would spring forth from there, proceed from there, be evident from there for all to see. And let's pray with the psalmist as you repeat after me. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know. Be still. Be. Amen. All right, this is a time when we consider our tithes and offerings, and we're still not quite ready to pass the offering plates, but we do have a couple of ways, three ways actually, that you can continue to give your tithes and your offerings. There are those buckets at the entrance to the sanctuary. You can drop your cash and your checks in there. One of the buckets is for the building fund. The other is for the general fund. There's also the post office box that's been set up specifically to receive your tithes and offerings. That's Baker Chapel, United Methodist Church, post office box 156, Boonville. And as I like to say, the way we give is online. That's the safest and the easiest way. Just go to the Baker Chapel website. There's a button you can press right there, and you can make your tithe and your offering that way. And as you consider the many gifts that you have been gifted with and the gifts that you return to God, let's have a song.
No more tears and no more sorrow, no more pain will I be. I'll live in peace with the Lord forevermore. I'll live eternally with my friends and family, going home to see the Master someday. Going home to see the Master, going home to see my Lord. Gonna cross over Jordan someday. Gonna leave this world behind me, gonna kneel before. I traveled around this big old world, but soon my travels will be old. My final destination is heaven bound, going home, see the Master someday.
Before we commune, just some instructions for those of you who might be back for the first time or never having had to commune with us this way. We commune and have been through the pandemic with these individual self-contained cups. And most of you are familiar with this, but if you're not, it has two seals on it. One is a clear seal. That's the top one. It's hard to see, and it's thin. So, but if you run your finger or your thumb over it, you can find it. And then that seal will uncover the wafer. The purple seal under that will uncover the juice, okay? This is the table of the Lord, and the invitation to the table is not my invitation. The invitation is the Lord's invitation. And his invitation is to everyone. Everyone. There is no practice in the United Methodist Church to deny communion to anyone who comes for it. That includes children. In some traditions, they like to wait until after some instruction and some baptism. If that's what you want to do with your children, that's perfectly acceptable. Just know that no matter what, the children are welcome. We leave that up to parents. If you want them to wait, they can wait. If you want them to come, they can certainly come. But there is no communion without confession, and so would you, even as I bow my head and close my eyes, would you bow your heads and close your eyes, and in silence before God, confess your sin. Lift your heads, and open your eyes, and hear the very, very, very good news. Christ died for us while we were still sinning. This proves his great love for us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. Come to the table of the Redeemer. Jesus invites you here as part of the people of God. Come to the table humbly, not because you've earned a place here, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love God and you want to love God more. Come because Jesus first loved us and gave himself for us. Come because you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Come because you want to experience the mystery of God's grace. On the night he was handed over, Jesus had a meal with his friends. He took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, he took the cup of wine, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, remember me." Let us pray. God, our Creator, thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. whose love pursues us our whole life long. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your life to us in word and deed, even unto death, even death on a cross. Come, Holy Spirit, feed us with your love, that we may be filled with power to love God with all our hearts and souls and minds. Amen. Would you stand and let us pray together the prayer that our Lord has taught us to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Let us pray. We have come to the Lord's table. We have eaten the bread of heaven. God is the one who will transform us so that we can see with Jesus' eyes, hear with Jesus' ears, speak with Jesus' mouth, so that we can be the body of Christ in the world, proclaiming the good news of God's reign. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
If you are able, would you please stand and join us for a song?
Never know how much it costs to see.
altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
So here
I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Thank you so much for worshiping with us through the live stream. Maybe someday you can join us in person. In fact, our service is continuing even right now. We are in a time of prayer when we're sharing with one another our joys and our concerns. Of course, we don't want to share those through the live stream out of respect for the privacy issues that are involved. But if you'd like to share a prayer request, you can do that through email. Just email your request to prayers@bakerchapelumc.com. And if you'd like to see the other prayer requests and you're not already on our mailing list, just add your email address. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. Continue to follow us here on Facebook, on YouTube, and at our webpage. And now receive the blessing. The love of God, the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you now and stay with you all the time. Amen.